This video covers our June 2021 performance figures for our solar PV, Tesla Powerwall 2 performance here in the UK, along with our Tesla Model 3 and Hyundai Kona electric usage, plus other things that happened during the month of June. So stay tuned. Hi. John here and welcome. I'd like to give a bit of an update on sort of key events that have happened during the month before I get into the stats and all the figures. First off was the installation of our new front door. There is a separate video on that installation, before and after and why we needed to replace it, and I'll put a link to that up here. Or is it here? Anyway, it's one of these sides. And it'll also be down in the description down below. So have a look at that if that's of interest to you. 4 weeks on from its installation, the improvement is just sort of astounding, really, from a sound perspective alone. It's so much quieter in the hallway. You can't hear the wind noises from outside. And I'm actually looking forward to colder months, and I will do some comparisons around drafts and take some thermal imaging shots to show you, compare it against how it was with the old door. Most people who have the Kefir MA120 electric smart meter, it's not sending half hour readings to the DCC or Octopus Energy. Ours has been basically a sitting duck since the 19th of May. It is an industry-wide issue, apparently, that Kefir, I think that's how you pronounce it, Kefir, are working on and rolling out some new firmware to fix this problem. As you can gather, at the 1st of July, as I'm the day I'm recording this, it's still not sending through data. The gas meter has also come out in solidarity with the electric meter. On the 16th of June, the LNG G470 gas meter no longer wants to send its daily readings. They would have been zero, as we have the gas turned off at present. However, it's not even bothered to push a zero through as a reading. So yeah, both meter readings out of sync, basically. In better news, we did a 600-mile round trip in the Tesla over 2 days, which was fabulous and so easy. I had planned to film it, record all the stats and the efficiency figures and share them all with you, but I never did. I can share some of the data, which I'll do at the end of this video, plus some awesome dashcam footage of a bird strike when we were in the Tesla. No harm was done. As normal, please comment, like, share. All of those actions help get this video shown to more people on YouTube, which in turn helps my channel grow. So thank you in advance for your support in doing that. Let's move into the solar and battery stats for the month of June, shall we? I'll bring up a graphic on screen, which you can pause the video if you want to review it. Certainly if you're not familiar with our setup and configuration, then have a look at that screenshot, or again, down in the description down below, there's a list of all our components for our system. Let's start off with our solar numbers. So for June 2021, our solar southwest facing array at 6.34 kilowatt hours panels arrays. Well, that's a bit of a mouthful. We produced a total of 764 kilowatt hours from the two separate arrays. We had a daily average solar generation of 25.5 kilowatt hours for the month. As you will see when we look at the day by day chart in a minute, we started off well, then solar production fell back from the middle of the month onwards. Please drop your solar totals and solar array size in the comments down below. It provides a really great comparison and resource for other people to look at. Plus, I find it very interesting as well. Oh, incidentally, if I don't comment straight away, it's because we're away all weekend. Well, we're at a craft fair all weekend, so I'm not going to get much computer time. So I will respond, but it may not be till Monday at the earliest. So please carry on and I will get to you. Let's have a look at our split of the two arrays. So our 4 kilowatt array produced 493 kilowatt hours, and our newer 2.34 kilowatt array produced 271 kilowatt hours. Interesting to note that the 4 kilowatt array produced 26 kilowatts more than the month against May 2021 total, whereas a smaller array did 3 kilowatt less than the May's total. I guess the position of the sun in the sky was the main reason for the difference between the two. I don't know. You with split arrays, tell me how you got on. Looking at the Powerwall 2 and solar performance to our overall self-power, let's have a look how we got on with that. During the month, I swapped between cost-saving mode and power-saving mode. If the weather looked iffy, we would be in cost-saving mode to pull from the grid as we needed to get through the expensive 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. peak period on battery power, certainly with the high price of the Agile tariff, the Octopus Agile tariff that we've been experiencing. If it was okay weather, then we would be on self-powered mode. 10 days during the month, we were in cost-saving mode, and the remaining 20 days, we were in self-power mode. The weather was changeable from day to day, from the middle of the month onwards. We were in self-power mode from the Powerwall and solar contributions for 87% of the time for over the month. And as you can see from the stack chart there, 59% of it came from solar generation and 28% came from the Powerwall. This chart compares the month of June from 2012 through to 2021. Values from 2020 onwards are for both arrays, whereas before then they are just for the single 4 kilowatt array. If you recall, the original 4 kilowatt array produced 493 kilowatt hours, whilst the new array achieved 271 kilowatt hours, making that 764 total you see there. Powerwall in and out. The Powerwall had our 88% round trip efficiency for the month for what it managed to store versus what it was able to supply. And the round trip efficiency seems very stable over the last 5 months at around 88%. We actually stored 261 kilowatt hours and it was able to supply 230 kilowatt hours. This chart gives you a little more detail on what happened day by day. Solar generation shown in yellow is strong at the beginning of the month and then it tails off on the 17th onwards, and the odd spike here and there after the 17th. The highest individual day was on the 5th of June at 43.1 kilowatt hours. The lowest recorded solar day was on the 20th of June at, sorry, excuse me for laughing, at 6.8 kilowatt hours. Quite a difference between the two. As you can see, house usage is in blue, and this covers all our house usage, so car charging, electric glass kilns running, and all the other house usage, essentially. Grid pull, shown in red, climbs steadily through the month from the 17th onwards. With not enough solar activity during some of the days, we ran the glass kilns overnight, which uses around 6 kilowatt hours, depending on the program that's chosen. Plus, the Powerwall would have charged up overnight when it was in cost-saving mode. We didn't export much back to the grid, which is shown in orange. Our largest single day's export was 4 kilowatt hours on the 5th of June. This day, if you recall, was our peak generation day for the month. Hence the export, as we could basically use all the power that we produced. This chart looks at the four data sources that we've just looked at in the day by day. The house usage shown in blue is perhaps the key one to focus on here at 879.5 kilowatt hours. Export was lower than May, at total at 46.4, with import being 144 kilowatt hours, which again was lower than May. Let's have a look at those in a little bit more detail on this following few charts. This chart is our average daily house usage and our average daily grid usage over the previous months. Our average daily house usage for June was 29.3 kilowatt hours, that's the blue line, and our average daily pull from the grid was down at 4.8 kilowatt hours a day from 5.8 kilowatt hours in May, that's the red line. Let's have a look at what we sent back to the grid. So this chart shows that we sent 46 kilowatt hours of excess solar generation back to the grid in June, a continuing downward trend, which is good to see, especially if we look at the month-on-month performance against 2020, when it was a bit dire. This chart shows what we pull from the grid each month, and in June we pulled 144 kilowatt hours, again a reduction over May's total, and mostly on par with June 2020 total. So have a look at the eddi. The myenergi eddi heats our hot water from surplus solar. I did actually forget to record the month-end screen on the eddi and the zappi, as I thought the month-end was today, Thursday, the day I'm recording this, is not yesterday, which was the Wednesday, the 30th. Duh. And it basically means I have got incomplete data for both those devices, which is a little bit annoying. From the myenergi app, it shows a monthly consumption saving of 61.6 kilowatt hours. And I took this photo of the eddi saving screen on the 1st of July, and it shows a yearly total of 208 kilowatt hours and an accumulative since installation of 676 kilowatt hours. The myenergi app doesn't currently show the year to date or the accumulative totals, which is a little bit frustrating. I know I've pointed this out before, however, it's worth mentioning again in case you've missed it or this is the first time you're watching one of these videos. The running month accumulative totals are a bit awry. For example, 61 kilowatt hours plus 159 kilowatt hours, the rolling total, equals 220 kilowatt hours, whereas the device screen shows 208 for the same data set. No idea why, but I thought I'd point it out just in case someone is doing the maths in the background. Normally I record the data that's shown on the eddi screen, but as I didn't take a photo of it, I obviously can't do that. Also, I'll draw your attention to the lack of saving calculations for this and the last month, and it'll be the same on the eddi, on the zappi as well. As our meters are not sending data to the DCC / Octopus Energy, we're not getting any bills. Also, the other apps I use to show savings and usage are in a similar boat as they rely on the same data set. So it's all a bit pants, really. It should all catch up once the firmware has been pushed to the meter, but we'll see in the fullness of time, won't we, whether that is the case or not. Finally, moving on to the cars. As I didn't take the month-end photo of the zappi screen, I don't have all the normal data to share, which I would normally do. I do, however, have some data from our road trip in the Tesla, which I will share with you. The Tesla Model 3 covered 1,444 miles during the month, bringing its total mileage to 12,113 miles. No issues or problems to report, no service schedule either. Tesla states, book it in if there's a problem. I will change the cabin air filter and check, clean and grease the brakes. Well, obviously not the brakes, but I guess that would be not good, but in the mechanisms, later in the year when it reaches 2 years old in September. During the month, we did 9 supercharging sessions where we added a total of 257.16 kilowatt hours, all for no costs. That is thanks to those kind individuals who used our Tesla referral code when ordering their cars. They get 1,000 free supercharging miles, as do we. So thank you to those of you who have used it. Hopefully some more of you will consider using our code when you place your order. It has to be used at the point of order rather than retrospectively. We charged at some new supercharging locations as well during the month. The Darts Farm in Exeter, which is a fabulous location, a massive farm shop, tea room, eatery, picnic area and so on. Tesla Service Centre in Bristol, eastbound Membry services on the M4. Oh, we've travelled. Interesting to note that the average charging time was 25 minutes over the month, over those 9 charges. So, you know, long enough to go to the toilet, get a cup of coffee and then return to the car and carry on your journey. On our return road trip, we used A roads and motorways and did 292 miles for 236 watt hours per mile, which works out at about 4.2 kilowatt hours per mile. And that would have been 70 mile an hour on the motorway and sort of 50 mile an hour on the A road. So quite fast driving, really. We took a scenic route on the way down and some of the way back. We did stop in the village of Tisbury in Wiltshire, which is just off the 303 near Stonehenge for a nose around and show our faces to the locals. So the 600 mile road trip to Cornwall and back over 2 days was a breeze in the Tesla. No charging issues or concerns. Most of the trip was completed using autopilot, which took away the tiredness and strain of keeping a foot on the accelerator and having to steer. So yeah, very, very enjoyable, and would always be our go-to car for longer journeys. Oh yeah, the bird strike. I was telling you about the bird strike. So here's the footage of us travelling up the A1 in a 50 mile an hour stretch, doing 50 miles an hour. And I saw this pigeon fly out from the driver's side at the Armco barrier sort of height. And it bounced against the driver's door and then flew off in the direction that it came from. So no damage to the car, no damage to the pigeon, just a bit of a pigeon outline from the chalky dust on its feathers. And I bet the pigeon sort of dined out on that story for a few weeks after it got back to its roost. Yeah, I hit a Tesla and bounced. It was brilliant. Should have seen it. They've got it on camera. the Kona. So the Kona covered 263 miles in the month and now has a total mileage of 12,082 miles. It now reminds me whenever I start it that it needs a service in 16 days. Since its last service 12 months ago, it's covered 2,100 miles. So, you know, that's it really. It's not going to be a massive service, but they're still going to go through the same old process and charge me 160 quid or whatever it is. Hey-ho. Okay, so that's it really. Any questions, any comments, then dive down below and I'll pick them up. As I said before, please do comment, like, share, subscribe if you haven't already, hit the bell notification icon, you know the score by now. Thanks for watching and I'll see you on the next video. All right, take care. Bye.